Divine Truth documentary. Jesus, Mary, and others provide information to people or organizations that produce documentaries. In this video, Jesus is interviewed by Thomas Leader while staying with Thomas and his cameraman Simon. This is session 8, filmed on the 14th of August 2013 in Moolooabah, Queensland, Australia.
Okay, so going back to miracles, if we use that word that everybody kind of understands.
Yes.
And you are at one with God. What type of things would you like to do?
Well, I have a growing awareness of what things we may be able to do, and I'm not certain whether we'll be able to do them or not at this particular point. But there is an awareness of the laws that are involved with particular things that are coming up now as I'm progressing and remembering different things. So these are the kind of things that I feel we may be able to do. I feel that there are laws that enable levitation to occur, not only of a person, but also a group of people, and even materials and objects. So I feel that will be able to be possible. I feel teleportation can occur, where we can just discover the laws that govern the ability to transmit any material, and eventually a human form, you know, and somebody transmit themselves, if you like, from one point on the planet to another point on the planet instantly, without there being a delay in time, or very little delay in time. And so I feel that we'll be able to formulate matter seemingly out of nothing. I don't believe there's any such thing as formulating matter out of nothing, because everything comes from somewhere, but it's a matter of manipulation of matter, basically, to make it appear like it's forming out of nothing. I feel we'll be able to still do things that we did in the first century, which is like cure human ailments. So if someone's missing a leg, we're able to have the leg grow back again. If someone's missing their sight, we'll be able to give them sight. If somebody has a disease of some kind, a cancer or other types of illness, depending on the laws involved, we may be able to cure them. When I say may, there will be laws involved that allow some people to be cured and other people not to be, depending on the kind of laws they engage. I feel that every single human ailment and every single human disease can all be cured. I feel that the way animals interact with humans will be very different to how they currently interact with humans. At the moment, they're interacting based on the damaged soul condition of humans, and therefore they're reflecting the damaged condition. Whereas once a person becomes at one with God, the animals that surround them will reflect the loving condition of the individual. So it'll seem like miraculous how animals act and behave in the presence of the person who's at one with God. Almost everything you can think of, in fact, I feel, will be able to be affected in some way. I believe the current teachings on mathematics, science, medical profession, and all of these other types of teachings where we're very physically focused, they will all change. And in fact, we'll learn far more new mathematical formulas that define how, for example, how teleportation occurs, and that define how levitation can occur, and define how other different material things can occur. We will learn the laws involved with how the physical body interacts with the spirit body, and we'll learn laws that enable us to create devices or mechanisms that allow spirits to communicate to people on earth who can't normally receive communications from spirits, and enable spirits to actually even portray themselves as a three-dimensional hologram to people on earth so that they can see what they look like in their spirit state. And these are all things that I feel that the laws are all there available for us to access, but humankind at this point in time is either unwilling or unable. Unwilling because they don't want to change their belief systems, or unable because of their condition of love to engage these particular laws.
Thank you. If I meant like that, sounds my head now, and sure.
I've just cropped in anyway, so
okay, great. All good. Oh no, it's wasn't that one.
Can I also say something about to me, I don't believe there are any miracles, but there are miraculous things. And when I say that, what I mean by that is that to me, some of the things God has created are absolutely amazing and still leave me in wonder and awe. And in particular, the thing that leaves me in the most wonder is the framework or the laws that allow things to happen. Like the whole concept that gravity occurs is one thing, but to have a law where you can predict how gravity occurs is quite another. And these are the things that I'm particularly fascinated about discovering, the laws involved, the frame, which is the framework under which we can create. And to me, that is the most fascinating area of study of all. What are God's laws? And God obviously created these laws before the inception of the universe, which meant that the laws existed before the universe existed. And how God maintains the framework of these laws. You know, these are fascinating areas of study, which are my primary areas of study now. Like, so rather than looking at how or what can be done, I'm more fascinated about how God created the law that enabled it to be done. Does that make sense? And so to me, these are really fascinating areas of study as well, that mankind generally has not even engaged at any level because of not understanding. To understand the framework of the laws that God's created, you've got to firstly believe in a God, and you also have to grow in love to a certain extent in the relationship with God to understand. And so to me, these are the most fascinating areas of study. They are the areas that I feel I will be engaging for many, many years to come, and if not for eternity, in fact.
So do you know how the world was created?
I have ideas or concepts. I suppose you would classify them as highly likely theories of how the world was created. Because the only way to really know is to do it yourself. And at this stage, I don't have no one who has created a world like the earth that we currently have other than God. And therefore, God is really the only person who knows for certain how everything came about. Of course, I do believe it is a worthwhile area of study, because in the long run, we will, I feel, be able to be involved in the creation of worlds of our own. So there is a high likelihood, I believe, that God, through this infinite progression that we have available to us, will share with us more and more truth about how to go about creating a world, for example. But all we can do at this point is understand the general. We are tracing the creation of the world through what the world shows us about its own creation, rather than actually knowing for certain what created it. Does that make sense? It's sort of like us here, humanity here in the year 2013, as we count time, can only look at records in the earth itself and in the universe itself to find out how the earth itself was created. And there is no other way, other than asking God directly, there is no other way of finding out how. And so what we have a tendency to do then is to study the effect of everything to work out how. And we work out through sort of reverse engineering, going backwards in time and making suppositions, which we then either prove or disprove scientifically. And that's the only real way that we can discover how anything was created, other than having God tell us. My personal opinion is it's far better to have God tell you, but to have God tell you, you've got to be in a condition where you can understand. It's sort of like asking a scientist who's working on, like a physicist who's working on nuclear acceleration of particles, how that all works when you have no background in nuclear physics whatsoever. You know, you first need to go and get a background in nuclear physics before you could understand what that scientist would probably be able to tell you. And I feel a lot of our relationship with God is like that too. We can only understand what God's going to tell us once we get the background of all the information that we need to learn that God can share, and have some degree or some what I would call foundation in knowledge. Then we can gain some understanding. To me, the foundation in knowledge is love. So if you understand that everything in God's universe and every one of God's laws are operating on the principles of love, and you understand the basic principles of love, then you have the capacity to understand how things came about and think how things were created. So in terms of the earth itself and how it's created, which is your direct question, can you see there's a lot involved in understanding how it's created? And just because I have a personal opinion about how the earth was created, that doesn't mean that that is God's truth about how the earth was created. To obtain God's truth about how the earth is created, I need to connect to God and be able to establish some kind of communication with God. And also, I need to have enough development, and I don't believe I have that full development at this point, you know, even after 2,000 years, to understand all of the laws involved that would allow for me to understand the laws of creation that involved in creating the earth. Does that make sense? So I sort of feel like some of the questions that people ask misunderstand the complexity of understanding that is involved to understand what is even being asked. And I believe many of these questions are asked because there's a belief that I'm God, and so therefore should be able to tell you how the earth was created. Does that make sense? But because I was not here when the earth was created, I cannot definitely say how the earth was created. I can only give you what I have learned through the 2,000 years of my investigation of how the earth was created. I can't give you God's truth about it because I'm not God. And unless I connect to God and ask God what God's truth is, and also have enough scientific development to understand what God's telling me, to then share it in layman's terms, I will not be able to share how it is, even when I, you know, have that development. So it's sort of like asking a physicist how to explain to a layperson how nuclear particle acceleration works, when the layperson has no knowledge in physics whatsoever, and the physicist has no knowledge about how the layperson thinks. And that is also a problem of communication, really, in the end. So my feelings are this. The only way we can answer these questions individually is for us to get the development where we can understand the scientific principles involved through experiments and through experimentation, get the development in love that is necessary to understand how all God's laws of the universe work, get the development where we're able to communicate with God on a permanent basis on these issues, then we will come to very good, clear understandings about how all these things work. Now, because I have not re-established my communication with God to that extent, it would be presumptive of me to state right at this point in time how all these things work, when all I would be giving is my own personal opinion and not God's principles or laws or God's truths. Once I become at one with God, then I can give an answer to many of these questions clearly without being presumptuous and also without misleading anybody. So I feel it's far better to wait until that time before I answer some of those kind of questions.
Yeah, thank you.
So there's a lot of things I could say about the creation of the world, the earth, the creation of the solar system in which we live, the galaxy in which we live, the Milky Way galaxy, the galaxies that surround us, how dark matter, dark flow, dark energy, and all of these other things of things that I do know about. But many of these things are only what I know currently, not at one with God again. And the problem with me talking about them now is there's going to be errors in them because I'm not in that at-onement condition with God again. So while I remember a lot of those things, there may be errors still within many of these things when I discuss them. And to be honest, I feel it's far better to discuss them accurately than it is just to give my personal opinion. That being said, I am willing to give my personal opinion, but I don't know if giving my personal opinion on a documentary, whether people interpret as a personal opinion. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I sort of feel like in the end they will interpret as, oh, Jesus said this is how it is. And in 6 months' time, if I work through something and find out that that's not it and change my mind, then they go, oh, Jesus didn't know what he was doing, basically. And that's fine. I'm okay with that. As long as they knew up front that I was saying that it's a personal opinion and not God's truth.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting. I think that's easy to say that this is a personal opinion. I think also that gets onto the area that you have opinions.
And I'm allowed to have opinions too.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So I'm...
Yeah. So the reality is, from God's perspective, I'm allowed to have personal opinions. The reality also is that many of my personal opinions are not going to be God's truth. The reason why is because I haven't discovered all of God's truths yet. Because God is an infinite God, logically, I cannot have discovered all of God's truths yet. And so therefore, I will have some personal opinions about how things may be, but I don't know for certain. And there's other things that I would know for certain once I've personally experienced them and once I've personally done the particular things involved. So, for example, when it comes to asking questions about the creation of the earth, I have never personally created an earth. So I don't know all the things involved in the creation of an earth. When you're talking about the creation of earth, you're really talking about the creation of a whole universe, because obviously the earth, if you look at it from the point of view of logic, the whole earth doesn't come from the creation of itself in isolation. So we're talking now about the creation of a universe. Now, I have not personally created a physical universe. Only God, as far as I'm aware, has ever done that. And so I do not, and therefore cannot, answer the questions through my personal experience. I can only answer it through what I suppose from what I have discovered over a period of time through my analysis of the universe itself, physical universe, which may be flawed given the fact that I don't know everything, given the fact, and I would say is going to be flawed given the fact that I don't know everything. So unless I knew everything, it's impossible for it to not be flawed. And I feel that's where we're at with regard to a lot of these things. I preface a lot of what I say, this is my personal opinion. But unfortunately, many people in the media and also many others neglect to include that in something that I've said. And they say what I said rather than the preface to what I said, which is, this is my personal opinion. This is not God's truth. And actually, this cannot be God's truth unless I have had the personal experience of it and know it to be true, and I am in a condition of at one with God that isn't broken by my statement of it. And so it's very plain to me that there are certain things that enhance my connection with God, and I know those particular things to be true. Then there's other things that are just my personal opinion, and it's highly likely that at some point in my future I will have to change my personal opinion on those subjects. And the creation of the world is one of them.
So, I'm just interested.
Yeah.
What's your opinion? What's your, of how it's created? Or is it too, is it?
Well, obviously it's very complex.
Well, yeah.
And so it depends on how much time now you want to spend on the discussion of the subject. And so that means now I've got to somehow shortly summarize something that's a very complicated process. Basically, if we can put it this way, the center of a galaxy is the birth of dark matter. Does that make sense? And matter keeps being transferred between the physical universe and the other universes that get created when a person enters a new condition of love. So every time a person enters a new dimensional state, which is a new condition of love, matter enters that dimension from the dimensions that existed in age older to that dimension. So for example, if I can give it a bit of a summary of how that works, matter from this universe, the physical, got transferred into the seventh dimension when I on Earth entered the new condition of love that no one else had entered yet. The seventh dimension was in that moment created because the laws of God allowed its creation. And then matter was transferred from the sixth dimensions underneath that dimension into that dimension, right? Through, and that's how it got created. So there was this transference of interdimensional matter that occurs between dimensions. And this occurs through centers, like these are the law of physics centers that govern the law of the physical laws of the universe, these center locations that transfer matter. Now, these places of the transference of matter are often referred to as black holes, or where light does not come out of, but rather seems to go into. And matter is chewed up by these holes. And matter is transferred from this physical dimensional existence, for example, into another dimension as those dimensions get created. And this is why the majority of matter that man has measured, for example, in our galaxy, can't be seen, because all of it is in interdimensional existences. Now, given that is the fact, we have processes that are basically the, through the law of cause and effect, processes that are the opposite of an equal reaction of the transference of matter. So we get the matter being transferred into the new dimension, and as a result, a growth of matter in the current dimension as well is an equal and opposite reaction in terms of balance. And this is how the whole universe, in fact, began initially. But after the universe began, we have these initial the centers of these galaxies and the centers of these black holes, which the Earth is actually rotating around, is my understanding currently, that our galaxy revolves around a supermassive black hole, but our own solar system revolves around another black hole that man hasn't measured at this point, that actually revolves around the galaxy as well. So there's a double operation in terms of revolving around these massive, but quite small in terms of linear size, but massive in terms of mass, transfer energy into matter. And so a lot of Einstein's theories about the transference of energy into matter have some physical, relationship between all of these particular events. But there's far more than that, because there is a dark flow that occurs, and dark energy that occurs, and dark matter, and energy is converted into matter. So the initial, you could say, creation of the physical universe was the result of energy being converted into matter. And this energy must have been immense, but came, I believe, my personal belief is, from God. And every time I talk to God about this matter, that I get confirmation that this, all of this energy that God has, got transferred into matter through some of the theories that we're now discovering, mathematical theories that we're now discovering. And as a result, the matter came into existence in one moment, and that's how the birth of the matter came. But then we've got to ask the questions about the scientific processes involved with regard to the establishment of the elements involved that eventually end up with the elements that are on Earth. So that's a whole different process that we need to discuss. So, like, to me, this is like days and days and days and days of discussion.
Yeah, it's too much. It's too big, I think.
Of what I understand it to be, and I don't...
It's too big.
Yeah, I don't really think that in the end it's very... To be honest too, I don't feel that it's very important. And that might sound strange, but to me there are more important things.
Well, it's only because people ask that question, don't they?
Well, they do, but to me they are not focused on the more important things. See, to me the more important things are happiness, enjoyment of life, love, the experience of love, both from God, and because it's the experience of love from God that allows you to conceive of these things, but also the experience of love with the other half of yourself, the experience of love of yourself, the experience of love of children and all those kind of things. These are all more important issues that will create more happiness in your personal life than understanding how the world came into being, 12 or whatever so billion years ago. Mm. to me, while these are fascinating areas of study, they are not as important areas of study as the issues of love. And this is why my primary focus of the areas of study are areas of love, not scientific matters. That being said, I do understand more in my pure state. I do understand more than any spirit does in the spirit world about how the universe came into being, but only through my relationship with God, not through my personal exploration of the universe. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So it's only because God told me, basically, through this communication process that you can establish with God, which is not based on thoughts or based on words, but based on this transference of love. The language of God is the language of love. Everything in the universe is also based on the language of love. Once you understand the language of love, you start understanding everything in the universe. And to me, that's far more important to know, because then you can ask questions about anything and get answers, rather than just saying, you know, rather than spending 500 years finding out how the earth came into existence through a whole series of experiments that may be even false at the end of that, and still not really knowing the end result, wouldn't it be far better to know how you can actually ask God the question and get an answer? You know, to me, that's more important. And so that's why I feel the primary areas of focus of mankind should be, and for myself is, firstly, establishing the relationship with God, then finding out the answers to the other questions. And so my process right now is, let me re-establish my relationship with God, then I'll be able to answer those questions. But to me, even then, the answer to those questions won't be that important.
Yeah.
And while they may be fascinating to other people, they still will not be important to me. Because to me, the most important thing we can discuss is God's love, the universal laws that God's created, the framework in which we exist, and the happiness that results from bringing our lives into harmony with those things.
Okay. I guess, are you on a question before? So there are 14, there are seven souls that came back.
Correct.
So can you explain to me why you came back? And what's the purpose of the seven souls and the 14 beings coming back?
Well, obviously, it took us a long time to understand how to come back. So, you know, and I think I've explained how in another question, but it took us a long time to explain how to come back and to discover how to come back. But once we did, it was around 1935 in terms of Earth time that we discovered how to come back and how to return. And that discovery was made firstly by myself and Mary. And then what we thought was that it would be better that more than myself and Mary come back. Because if the trouble with just myself coming back or myself and Mary coming back is that it's highly unlikely that there were a number of ways we could come back too, by the way. So we could have at that point in time chosen to come back through a materialization. And that had been available to us at that time, a permanent materialization. In other words, we create a body, a fully formed, mature body, and we just connect to that body and basically just appear. The problem with coming back that way is that it doesn't challenge many of people's belief systems at all in reality. And in fact, in a lot of ways, would have created more unrealistic belief systems on the planet. Many people would have believed we were beings from outer space or beings from some other universes. Many of them would have perhaps even worshipped us because they would have thought that, you know, we're not normal. And we didn't want any of those particular things to occur. So we decided against coming back through materialization of a form and then animating that form. We could also come back by materializing a lot of things altogether, like what you would classify as an environment, if you like, in which we are present. That would have even been worse than the first option in terms of causing people to believe all sorts of things that wouldn't be true. And it also doesn't help them understand how we got to that condition. So if we came back on Earth in a specific condition, in the condition that we actually had, in the spirit world at the time of 1935, then the majority of people on Earth would have believed that we were God, which was something that we definitely wanted to, reverse, because already that's a problem. And we wanted to show and demonstrate to people that progression towards God is the result of our condition, not that because we're gods or anything like that. So we decided against coming back in using all of these different methods that were available to us at the time, except for one. And the one method we chose was the method of reconnecting to a conceived form. It's just the same as a normal incarnation would occur. Connecting to a conceived form where two bodies are created, and then animating those two, or connecting to those two bodies through our soul, and then slowly having that soul, those two bodies, develop over time, just like the average person would do, until such a point in time that we recognized who we were, which now for myself has happened, and for Mary, she's going through that process, and for Cornelius, he's going through that process. But for many others of the 14, they know who they are, but they're not recognizing the process yet. Going through the process and then demonstrating all these wonderful things that can be done after we've gone through the entire process. The beauty of doing it that way is that everybody learns through their interaction with us how to do it themselves. And that's what we wanted to achieve. How you, anybody else, can connect to God, and the results of connecting to God, what it achieves in the long run. And what the results are once you develop more fully and allow this development to occur. We wanted to illustrate all of that. So at that point in time, we made the choice to return through that process, through being conceived again, bodies being conceived again, the spirit and material bodies being conceived again through the procreative process that's normal on the earth, our soul connecting to those bodies, and then slowly developing over time an awareness of the soul's connection and who that soul was. And we decided to choose that method because it had the greatest amount of ability to teach the most people what to do by a documented experience, knowing of course that most of us would be born in an era where you could take photographs, potentially have videos of our record of our development, and therefore have a complete or a relatively complete record of how to develop towards God and the subsequent results of doing so, what happens when you do so. So we chose that method fairly early in the process of deciding. Then, of course, we felt that if just two of us did it, there were risks involved. So there were risks involved at the time of conception, since nobody had ever done it before. There were risks that we could potentially kill the body with too much energy. So in other words, our parents conceive and then we connect to those bodies, and unfortunately the physical body dies as a result of too much energy being put into those bodies from our soul, which already had a lot of energy. And the problem with that is that then we would have instantly arrived in the spirit world in a spirit body that's not even formed properly yet, and had to go through the process of developing in the spirit world, which would have negated the entire point of coming to Earth, and we'd have to go through that entire process again and try that again. And so we had to be very careful about how much energy was being connected to the physical bodies that were created by the conception process. So there were some risks involved. If we put too much energy into the conception process, after the conception process, then there's a risk of passing instantly, and therefore the whole point of coming being negated through that process. There was also the risk of passing too much energy through our mothers, and therefore killing our own mothers who were involved in the procreative process. It was an experiment. We had to experiment and try to work out through mathematical laws about how much energy we felt the body could handle, how much of a connection we could handle, how much attenuated the connection had to be, and so forth. And once all of those, what you would call physical factors, were determined, then we decided that because there were some risks associated with the process, that it would be great if more than one of us, more than one pair of souls returned. And in the end, we had finished up having, we were able to have a discussion with the others who had yet to obtain that position, that condition, And we discussed those one, with those ones who we saw would probably obtain the condition first, and we asked them how many of them would like to return to Earth with us. And as it turned out, the first seven soul couples that achieved a unified a union state decided they wanted to all return. So there were seven who decided they wanted to return. And that meant waiting for the last of those seven couples to achieve a unified condition before returning. And that was achieved shortly before 1962. So it took another 30 years or so for the unified condition to be achieved by the seventh soul pair that arrived into that condition. Once that happened, then we could start the whole process. And I decided to go first. So I went first, and Mary decided to go after the majority of people had incarnated, so other than four. So she decided to go a fair way down just to help manage the process, if you like, and help everyone through the process. So that's why there's a bit of a gap between myself and Mary's age in terms of the delay between the incarnation process. But what that resulted in was that seven pairs, 14 people, returned to Earth from the period of 1962 through to the period, I think, of about 1988, 1989. It was the last incarnation of those seven couples and 14 people. And so that now means that the youngest of these couples is around 25 years of age. And the oldest is myself, and I'm 50.
So do you know where all the couples are, and have you had connections with them?
I do know where all the couples are. I have not met in the physical some of them. So there's two that I have not physically met. The rest I have met. Many of them do not know who, some of them do not know who they are yet. In other words, they've not gone through the process that I've gone through or that Mary's gone through in terms of having a recollection or an understanding of the memories they've been having through their life. And some of them are living just what you'd classify as a normal sort of a life here on Earth without an awareness yet of who they are. Others have had an awareness of who they are, but they don't want to go through the process emotionally. They don't want to go through the psychological process of examining their memories and working their way through the emotions connected to their memories. So there's many in that condition. There's about six in that condition. And there's a few that know exactly who they are, but are completely refusing to go through the process because they feel it's going to be too traumatic. So that's the current status. And there's myself who's gone through a large amount of the process, but not completed the process. And I don't expect my part of the process will be complete within the next 5 years. So I think it'll be another 5 years before I complete what I feel complete the process in terms of getting back in the condition of atonement with God. Mary is at the stage where she's still addressing a lot of her fears. So she's still at the stage where I was around 9 years ago. But with the potential to progress much more rapidly than I did because Mary can discuss a lot of these things with me and learn how to do them from how I did them. Cornelius is at a state probably around 2 years ago for Mary, where he's just starting to develop a desire to actually work through the memories and work through his emotional condition. And then there's others who know who they are, but who have no desire to work through anything at this point. They don't want to go through the psychologically distressing and emotionally distressing period of working through those kind of issues. And they also have a strong desire to just live a normal life, mostly because of fear, mostly because they're afraid of what other people will think of them. And then there's a few of them who believe that they are going to have some miraculous transformation that God puts them through rather than having to do any work themselves. And there's a couple of them that actually believe that that will be the case, and it won't be the case, but they still want to believe that will be the case. And so they're sort of, they're knowing, they know who they are, but they're just waiting for God to do something about it, basically. And of course, God's not going to do that. It's based on their will. But at this point in time, they're refusing to actually acknowledge that.
Do you remember, you want to say?
Yeah, okay.
Do you remember seeing Cornelius in the first century?
Certainly, yes. You know, I remembered his involvement in my life in this life way before he knew of his involvement in my life in this life, because he had memories after myself about all of that. I never discussed them with him, but you know, I have memories of him being he was a fellow who he came to Jerusalem primarily with the Roman army. He was a centurion, and he was a leader of a group of Romans, part of the Roman, and he was one of Pilate's henchmen, I suppose you could call him, based in Jerusalem. He was basically one of the ways in which Pilate controlled things for the Romans in Jerusalem. However, and he went to many other locations, of course, before he came to Jerusalem, but I met him when he came to Jerusalem, and he was assigned, because of Herod's request to Pilate, he was assigned to oversee any bigger gatherings that were where I was involved. So what happened was he had a troop of his army, which he would go along with, to, because sometimes there was upwards of 3,000 people listening to me at any one point in time. And so there was always a concern when that amount of people gathered, particularly if they were Jews, that there'd be some kind of revolt, and Pilate was interested only in quelling any revolt. And so they were often assigned, and sometimes large numbers were assigned to be around us while I was speaking. As a result of that, Cornelius came to many of my discussions and many of what you would call nowadays my seminars. And so he naturally listened. And after a while, after listening for some time, he started believing many of those things that he heard. And in fact, he at one point in time had a slave who was dying, and he asked me to cure him, and I did. And so that increased his faith in what I was speaking of to him. But unfortunately, Pilate learned of his association and his belief in my teachings. And so Pilate assigned him to the detail that nailed me to the stake, nailed me to what's called the cross nowadays. So he was actually asked to nail the nails into my wrists and into my feet when they put me on the stake. And that was his last straw. That's the thing that he decided he couldn't do. So he did nail the nail into my wrist, but became so distressed at having to do it that he just threw the hammer down and he deserted the Roman army. It was very unusual for a centurion to desert the army, being such a long-standing officer in the army. And as a result, Pilate and many of the people who hated him at the time, obviously he got to his position through a lot of violence, and which meant he was hated by quite a lot of people, wanted to make an example out of him. And so he died by torture 2 weeks after my own death. Mm. And I've only told you the things that Corny remembers.
So you remember a lot more of
Yes. Right. But it's not wise for me to discuss with you memories that he is yet to have. Mm. Because I don't want to suggest things to him. I only want to relate things that I remember about him that he has also had a memory of.
Can you explain to me about the connection with Padgett and the because am I right in thinking that his wife died and communicated with him, and he used to write down communications?
Yeah, so Padgett was a man, a lawyer, who lived in the late 19th century, early 20th century. And that's right, isn't it? 1900 to 2000 is the 20th century. I keep forgetting how we do things. Yeah. That's correct.
Can you just think of that from the top?
Like, sorry.
That would just make the edit easier.
Yeah. It's the 19th century from 1800 to 1900, yeah. Isn't it? That's right, yeah. Yes. No.
So. Yeah. My question's there. Do you want me to say the question again?
Yeah, you may as well.
Okay. So can you explain to me about Padgett and because I believe that his wife died or passed and communicated with him, and he used to write down her communications.
Correct, yes. He was a man who existed in the late 19th century, early 20th century. He passed in 1923, I think it was. And in around 1914, or just before 1914, his wife passed. And his wife entered the spirit world. He was very distressed at his wife's passing, and as a result, he started going through a lot of emotions. Now, he was a lawyer, but he had always had a mediumistic ability. And we had known of his mediumistic ability for a long time, which we often do when you're a spirit. When you're a spirit, you're looking at the earth frequently and going, there's another mediumistic person, there's another mediumistic person, and you're hoping at some point that they'll engage their ability. But most people don't finish up engaging their ability for all sorts of reasons. But Padgett, through the death of his wife, decided to try to engage the ability, because he was told when he went to a medium, another medium, that he had the ability to automatic write, which was the ability to transmit messages from spirits by writing them down. And so Padgett decided, in his grief, he decided to try this with his wife. And his wife started channeling material to him or giving him material that he wrote down. And so he wrote down quite a number of messages. And then he decided to talk to his wife about where she was. And so he found out where she was, and he found out that she was actually quite bound to him on earth. And he'd always had a belief that you shouldn't do that, that you should move on in the spirit world. You know, you should discover new things. And so he encouraged his wife to discover new things. So here we have a man on earth who firstly connected to his wife in the spirit world because of his grief. But eventually he's trying to convince his wife, who's in the spirit world, to try to discover new things rather than just resting on old beliefs. And his wife decided to engage that. So she went to Padgett's grandmother, who had been in the spirit world for quite a long time. Now, Padgett's grandmother and I met many years prior to this. She passed as a Christian. She eventually worked out that many of her Christian beliefs on earth were incorrect. And so she eventually asked Jesus to come to her to talk to her about what is the truth about the Christian beliefs. And because I often receive such requests in the spirit world, I went to her. I decided to go to her and talk to her. And so we met. And in the process of meeting, we developed a friendship, of course, as you do with people who you talked with eventually. And so Padgett's grandmother knew me personally. And it's not something that a lot of spirits in her condition could claim, because it was not frequent for a person under the celestial spheres to know me personally in the spirit world. They might have seen me at a distance, but many don't know me personally, and that I haven't had a personal conversation with them. So in her case, I had. So when Helen Padgett, James' wife, went to his grandmother and found out, you know, that she'd been conversing with me, she found out also a lot about the divine truth, which she started to put into practice. This, of course, meant that she started channeling this kind of material to Padgett. She started talking to him about her experiences, which, of course, piqued his interest, because he had always been interested in Christian religion. He was I think it was a Uniting or something related to the Uniting Church, but I'm not certain at this point. But I can't remember, but it's probably not that important. But she conversed with him about his belief systems, and eventually she brought me to him, to channel to him, which of course he didn't believe in the first instance, and he actually screwed up the message and threw it in the bin. And there were a number of messages, in fact, that I channeled to him that that he didn't keep, that he believed it was just somebody claiming to be me or whatever. But eventually we managed to bring to him a lot of people who confirmed that he knew personally, who confirmed that I was actually writing messages to him. So eventually we got to the point where he most of the time trusted that I was writing messages to him when I was writing messages. And so this gave me the ability to channel through this handwriting large amounts of material that I had not previously been able to put back on earth since the first century. And since there was a large amount of distortion from the Bible over many, many centuries of what I actually taught, this enabled me to correct many of the things that I, you know, wanted to see corrected on earth without me having to come to earth, which I'd always been wanting to do, but I hadn't yet discovered how to do. So this was before 1935, by the time myself and Mary had discovered how to return to earth. So we wanted to give this material to the earth, and we felt the only possible way to give the material to the earth was to find the person who was willing to channel the material, but also willing to channel the material we gave them rather than channel their own, you know, write down their own ideas, you know. Now, while Padgett did often write down some of his own ideas, we managed to channel a quite significant portion of material to him about divine love and about divine truth and about how God interacts with people and the fact that God is not a punishing God and God's only a God of love, and that, you know, we managed to correct many conceptions. But unfortunately, because of his emotional condition at the time, he was quite a shy person about these matters, so he didn't speak openly very often about what he was doing. A lot of the material never got shared. And so to our frustration, when you say frustration, you know, it was like we wanted it shared, but nobody was sharing it. And as a result, it nearly actually completely died, with the exception of another man who was a friend of his, a doctor, who got the material and eventually published it nearly 40 years later. And so now we're talking like years after we channeled the material, it was eventually published and put into published form. And it's very interesting to me because it also helped me with my memories of other things in this life. So it's actually interesting in the sense that it almost turned out to be a message or a letter from myself to myself. How spooky does that get? And so I've it's helped me a lot in terms of remembering everything about my life and working my way through specific issues. And a lot of people claim that I only teach what's in the Padgett messages, which is not true. I have a vast majority of information that I teach has never been recorded in the Padgett messages. But obviously I have a deep love for them because they are messages that I channeled to a man on earth on over 100 years ago now, or close to 100 years ago now.
Fascinating. So you hadn't heard of that side, have you?
They're worth reading, actually.
Yeah, I would love to.
There's 2,000.
Are the originals anywhere?
Yes. I have a friend in the States who has about 90% of the originals. And wow. He's in the process at the moment of scanning them and or photographing them. And eventually we hope to put them on the internet, all the originals, all the original handwriting.
Yeah.
From 100 years ago, yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
From my perspective, just to see like an original. Yeah.
The way it works originally is that there's a flow, it's understandable words, but there's no punctuation. So it's very hard to read.
Right.
There's no punctuation, there's no full stops, there's no commas, he was writing flat out, and we were giving him a lot of information. So he was writing flat out and he didn't have time to stop for punctuation, capitalization, any of those kind of things. So it just all like flows. And then the doctor eventually got all of the messages and did the painstaking labor of typing them, actually putting them in type eventually and putting them, punctuating them and all sorts of things like that. So it was some time. That's why it took him so many years, because he did it almost alone without much assistance.
What's the book called?
You can actually buy them on the net now. Some of them are called the Padgett messages. There's a number of different versions of them now from different editors. So there's an editor called Joseph Babinski, and he's made a complete library of many of the messages. There's some of the editors are from 30 years ago, you know, so there's a whole series of books. Some of them are called The True Gospel of Jesus.
Right.
Some of them are called Angelic Revelations of Divine Truth. They're all named or differently, but they're all basically messages. The best way to read them, I feel, is in chronological order. And the person who's done them in chronological order is, he's an editor in the States called Joseph. What did I just say before? His name? Joseph Babinski.
And does any of the books actually have like a scan of actually what the real writing looked like?
I think he has included at the back of one of the books some scans of what it looked like. Yeah. But eventually what we want to do is actually get the original and then we want to get the edited version and put them side by side on the net. Yeah. But that's a project that a man in the States called Michael Bailey is working on voluntarily, so he's taking him some time. But we'll see him again in a few months' time, so we'll see how he's going with it. But I think he's got almost 90% of it complete. So, yeah, but it's a big job. There's altogether it's close to 2,000 messages from all sorts of spirits. And I think altogether there's nearly 8,000 or 9,000 pages of text.
Gosh.
And it's all, some of it's crumbling, some of it's been treated fairly badly. It's 100 years old. So it's all, you know, from 1914 to 1923.
Mm.
Okay.
Get a cut there. So let's change the old ninja battery.
Okay. There's also other books that are interesting to read too that you'd probably be fascinated reading actually. There's a whole series of books that were channeled in the 19th century, the 20th century again, by another man called Robert James Lees that contain a lot of divine truth as well, and he channeled those over a period of 31 years, and they have also been now edited by Joseph Babinski and put into they're books by Robert James Lees, and they're called Through the Mists, The Life Elysium, and The Gate of Heaven.
Okay.
Mm. I've got them on PDF if you want.
Yeah, great.
Yeah. I've got all the Padgett messages on PDF if you want. They're all downloadable from our website.
Oh, right, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Mm. It's just to see the writing. I'd love to see the writing, the actual...
Yeah, I don't know if I've got any shots of the writing. I've got a few of them somewhere. I've got a few of them somewhere, yeah. But I can't...
So how long did it actually take to... because obviously he was writing and writing and writing, but for how long were you giving the messages? Or?
Well, it was interesting what happened because he went through emotional phases where he was quite clear and then other times when he was not that clear.
Right.
And when he was not that clear, it sort of distorted the message so much that we had to stop channeling. And we'd tell him, look, mate, you know, you're not that clear, you know, like you have to get into a better condition.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we're not going to be able to go so far. Now, what happened was that his best condition was shortly after his wife's death and when he worked through some emotions. And that was sort of from 1915 to 1916. And then in 1917, he started getting back involved being a lawyer. He was a lawyer all that time, but he started working a lot more, working nights, working weekends. He got involved with another woman eventually. And as all of those things happened, he channeled less and less, and his condition wasn't that great for channeling. So from 1917 onwards, the messages, the clarity and the... our ability to transmit clearly to him degraded until the time about 1919. I could not channel to him anymore after that without him distorting every message, so
right.
And almost everything that was said in the message. So
So I stopped channeling to him earlier than other spirits stopped channeling to him. I think the very last recorded message was 1923, but that was from other people.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Let's quickly... I know it's going to be very difficult for you to summarise, but it'd be quite nice to have a summary of what is divine truth.
Yeah, very important, actually. Yeah, very important.
Okay. Yeah.
Mary's back.
Mary's back.
Yeah. So maybe we need to just eat.
How's it going?
Good.
So, how do you explain genetics?
I suppose I first must ask where you're coming from with the question, because
hereditary genetics. So why a child will have the same eye shape as a mother, or same hair colour, or same build.
Okay, so if we look at what I'm talking about with regard to the way in which the human is formed, you've basically got a soul of which you are one half, connected to your two bodies. And I'm saying the two bodies were created at the time of conception. Now, at the time of conception, you have an intermingling of the genetics of your mother and the genetics of your father, creating your genetics. So there's a gene that's created through the first point of conception. And then because you could say the DNA, the genetic code, contains now everything about you. It contains about you physically, though, not about your personality, about your physical nature. So absolutely everything about your physical nature and your physical future development in that nature is determined by the genetic code. Now, unfortunately, though, with the way in which humans analyze the genetic code, we don't realize that much of the genetic code's distortions, the problems that occur in the genetic code, are all to do with emotional conditions from the human soul. So what we don't understand, and this is something that needs to be far more investigated far more thoroughly by the scientific and medical communities, is we just examine everything from a physical perspective. We look at everything from a physical point of view. What I'm saying is there is also a spirit body which is physical in its nature, which exists in a different dimension concurrently with the physical body. But beyond that, there is a soul. And that soul didn't come from the human couple when they conceived a new child. That soul, of which you are one half, came from God's creation directly. As such, it does not have the genetic code or any relationship to the genetic code that the human couple created through the procreation. So when we focus on genetics on Earth, and we focus on genetic even disorders on Earth, we are not factoring in this third and even more powerful part of our nature, which is the soul, the real self. The two bodies are just almost robots, or you could say they are organisms that allow the half of our real self, of, you know, the half of the soul. I am one half of a soul. Mary is the other half of my soul. The bodies allow the half of my soul to integrate with the different types of dimensions that are available. So the physical body has been created specifically for the purpose of the person to integrate with the physical universe. So the soul has the ability to have information fed to it from the physical body through the connectivity cords that connect it to a spirit body, which are also then connected to the soul. And so all this information, feelings, as well as thoughts and other things, emotions, these all flow from the sensory apparatus of the physical form through the channels, which are called, you know, spirits call one of them the silver cord and the other one the golden cord, into the soul. And the soul becomes a storehouse of every experience. Now, when we look at genetics, we're basically just focused on the physical body, but not realizing that the spirit body also has its own genetic code. And the soul is completely independent of the genetic code of both bodies. So what is the real self? The real self is the human soul, and the two bodies are just apparatus that the human soul uses, which have been created by its parent, the physical parents of the physical bodies, as the human soul uses it as the apparatus to experience the universe in which it lives at the time. So if it's a physical body, the soul uses the physical body as the apparatus to experience the physical universe at the time. And with the spirit body, the soul uses the spirit body as the apparatus to experience the spiritual universe, or the other dimensions, other dimensional spaces other than the physical. That being the case, can you see that genetics are a combination of a number of things? Firstly, they're the combination of the physical genetic code of the two human parents, in this case, if we're talking about human genetics. And there is another input upon or effect, a cause that affects the development of that genetic structure, and that is the soul itself. And I feel what's happening on the planet a lot is that we are just looking at the physical. We totally negate the spirit body as another influence, and we totally ignore the fact that there is a hot soul behind the whole lot of it that wasn't created by the human couple who conceived, but rather by God. And once we understand how the human is created, then we can start understanding what are the true sources of things like genetically formed illnesses, genetically formed genetic malformations, but also why we look the way we do. So the reason why you look different than I is because we had two different human parents with two different genetic injections, if you like, into our structure. And once that genetic basis is formed, we can't vary it with this physical body. However, that is completely independent of the soul. The feelings, the emotions, the knowledge, and all the other things that you have are completely independent of those things. So the physical body, I feel what we need to do on Earth is get away from this constant focus on the physical, constant focus on the physical body. And we need to understand there is far more going on than just the physical. And once we understand that, we'll understand all of the potential causes of any problems that we face genetically, but also we'll start to understand genetics in its whole framework, which is a framework of a physical organism having a physical replication structure compared to the soul, in the case of a human, that connects to it. In the case of a animal, it has a genetic structure, which is a physical genetic structure, and it has a spirit genetic structure if it has a central nervous system, but it does not have a soul. And so therefore the influences upon an animal are very, very different to the influences upon the human. And once we understand these differences, and once we connect with all these differences, we understand why everything works the way it does, if we understand it completely. If we understand everything that's a part of it. When we just examine one area, like human genetics, and we focus on that area as the cause of disease, for example, then we are ignoring the operation of the spirit body. We are ignoring the operation of the human soul. It's a bit like saying, and you might have heard this analogy before, where in the USA, they did a study and they found that in summer there was a higher consumption of ice cream. Now that wouldn't take much to probably assume, would it? But they found that that's the case, of course. They also found that in the summer there's a higher incidence of violent crimes in the summer as well. Now, would it then be wise to put those two things together and say, violent crime is caused by the consumption of ice cream? Of course it would not, right? Because there are many other factors that are involved in why those things occur. And what that's basically what we're doing when we say, when we take human genetics on its own without understanding that there's a spirit body, there's a soul, what we're really doing is we're looking at all the effects of something, and then we're making a heap of suppositions which don't take into account the other factors that are far more powerful effects on the body itself and the genetic structure of the body, or and even the genetic structure of anything. And so once we understand and once we accept that there's far more going on than what we imagine currently, and in our arrogance, I think, humanity has a tendency to be quite arrogant in the sense of assume that it knows everything about a subject before it even knows hardly anything about the subject. And this prevents us from taking into account possible alternatives. And the problem with that is that we are never going to understand how anything works when we do that. So I feel when it comes to a discussion about genetics completely, obviously it's a very complicated subject from a physical perspective, but we can nail it down, I feel, to these possibilities. We don't know everything that's going on with the genetic structure of any living thing on Earth, because we are not factoring in the dark matter, dark energy, or you could say the spirit body part of its life. And we are definitely not factoring in for the human soul, and what effect that has on the development of the human. And if we factored in all of those kind of things, we perhaps would be far less arrogant and far more investigative in our decision to, when we're looking at the human form, we start to want to investigate not only it in its physical presence, but also it in its spiritual presence, as well as in its soul form. And if we did that, we'd have a lot more knowledge at our fingertips about what's going on with all sorts of things, including disease, suffering, pain, emotional issues, what happens when you move from one dimension to the other, and all these other fascinating subjects could all be, you know, discussed and debated with far more freedom than they currently are.
Thank you. So could you explain to me the role of the spirit body?
Well, if we look at the role of all the bodies, it's like the physical body has the role of allowing the soul, the half of the soul, to interface with the physical world. Now, once the physical body dies, the half of the soul has learnt how to interact with the physical world, and can use a spirit body to interact with the physical world, but it's learnt all the things involved with the physical world, you know, physical laws. The spirit body is now used, once the physical body dies, by the half of the soul, now we're talking, to integrate and understand and accept all the sensory inputs from the spiritual world, the spiritual dimensions. Or you could think of them as some people refer to them as spheres, and other people refer to them as, you know, multidimensional spaces, or whatever you want to refer to them as, that the spirit body is the thing that experiences those spaces. I've explained how two spirit bodies of the same development can't occupy the same space at the same time, but a spirit body and a physical body can occupy the same space at the same time because they're in different dimensions. But both bodies, the physical and the spiritual, are not necessary for a completely unified soul to exist. So in the long run, both the physical body and the spirit body are just appendages we need to learn things for a specific period of time. After that period of time passes, we now don't need those particular bodies in order to experience those same things, because the soul has learned how to experience those things without needing the bodies in order to experience them. So both the physical body and the spirit body are temporary appendages to the soul, and are not needed in the long, like in infinite future, will not be needed in order for the soul to completely express itself.
Okay. So do you believe dinosaurs roamed the world?
Definitely. I know for certain because I've seen them in the spirit world. Everything that has a central nervous system on Earth, when it dies, it also has a spirit body, because at the time of conception, if there's a central nervous system in the physical body, a spirit body is also created for the same organism. So So the spirit body contains the mind of the being, and the brain is the expression of the spirit body's mind. So every single animal that has a central nervous system has a spirit body created. And when the animal itself dies on earth, the animal, the spirit body, still exists of the animal, and the animal still exists in the spirit world, in the other dimensions. And so when you use as your primary function your spirit body, you can go to places where there are dinosaurs. There's plenty of places in the spirit world, in the, particularly in the first and second dimensions of the spirit world, that have dinosaurs, and also every other living creature that had a central nervous system that has ever existed on this planet that has become extinct, there is in the spirit world. And there's millions of them, not just one of them. So you get to see dinosaurs, you get to see dodo birds, you get to see all of the, you know, all of the things that mankind has made extinct over all of these different periods of time, and all of the things that naturally became extinct, all of them have arrived in the spirit world. And you get to see them and you study them, and they have the same dominant characteristics generally that they had on Earth, with some exceptions, because when they're on Earth, they're influenced by the soul condition of people on Earth. When they're in the spirit world, they're influenced by the soul condition of people in the spirit world. And so in the second dimension, for example, dinosaurs don't eat each other anymore, whereas in the first dimension, they still attempt to, because of the condition of the people that surround them.
Interesting, thank you. And please say no if this is a bit too futile. I just think people would be interested. The sort of the famous conversations that you may have had in the spirit world.
Famous conversations.
It's been documented that you've spoken to Elvis or.
Yeah. See, what people on Earth view as famous people obviously are not the same kind of famous people in the spirit world. So there are many people who have been completely unknown on Earth who are very famous in the spirit world, because they've had a different life in the spirit world and therefore achieved different things and become famous through some of their achievements, some of their discoveries. Some of them are scientific discoveries. Some of them are discoveries of different ways of doing things, and some of them are discoveries of divine truths, like God's truths. So what a person on Earth believes is a famous person is very, very different to what a person in the spirit world may see as a famous person. Also, once you become at one with God, you don't sort of see another person as a famous person. So I'm not looked upon in the spirit world as a famous person. I'm looked upon as a normal guy, a normal soul. I just happened to be the first soul that discovered God's love in terms of its reception and the transformational effects of it. And so myself and Mary are famous from the point of view that lots of people know us, but we're not viewed with, we're not worshipped in any way, and we're not, viewed of as different to everybody else or any of those kind of things. So from my perspective, when I meet you, to me, you're just as famous to me, it doesn't make sense, as what a famous person on Earth might be. So if I say, I talked to Elvis the other day, that's the same for me as saying, I talked to Thomas the other day. To me, you both have just as much importance. You have just as much, my desire to listen to you and interact with you is just as strong as each other. With the exception that if I meet somebody that has very similar desires to mine, then I might spend a bit more time with them, just like anybody else would. But that all being said, of course, myself and Mary, because we're well known historically, there's lots of people who have talked to us, as you would expect. There's lots of people who have wanted to talk to us or come to talk to us, and or who have requested that we go to talk to them. And as a result, we get to see many people, some of whom are so-called famous people from Earth. And historically famous people, but we don't see it as any more significant or less significant than talking to any person on it, even a person who was unknown when they're on Earth and had no friends and had no family to know that they knew of, and they died completely unknown. We feel they're just as important to us to interact with than a person who's so-called a famous person. I find it interesting that people on Earth want to know about the famous conversations. And to me, some of the most famous conversations in terms of the well-known conversations of divine truth that have occurred between myself and others have occurred between myself and Mary and people that are almost totally unknown or completely unknown on Earth. But in the spirit world, they're famous conversations. Does that make sense? But yes, we have spoken to people like Elvis, Gandhi, you know, people like that. Obviously, we've spoken to lots of the kings and queens of England. And I was asked a question on Sky Telly, I think you heard it the other day, of, you know, if someone came along to me and claimed they were the Queen, you know, Queen Elizabeth I of England, or I think, who was the other person? Napoleon, that's right, you know, the French lieutenant. And they said, you know, if someone came along claiming to be them, what would you say to them? And I said, well, I know for certain that that person on Earth claiming to be them isn't them, because I've talked to those two people. They just happened to mention two people I have actually talked to in the spirit world. And so I can say definitely you're not them, because I know where they are, and you know, and this is where they are. And they thought it was a clever answer, but not necessarily a truthful one at the time. But the reality is I met Queen Elizabeth I in around 1916, actually. It was the first time I personally met her in the spirit world, and mostly because of my interaction with Padgett. She came to Padgett in a very dark condition and wanted help. And I met her as a result of her coming to Padgett. With regard to Napoleon, I met him in a very similar way. His soulmate came to Padgett to talk to Padgett. And as a result of meeting his soulmate, I eventually met Napoleon. So I've met those people, and I know where they are in the spirit world. And there's certainly no one on Earth who's Napoleon or Queen Elizabeth I. Whether somebody claims to be so or not, it's not true. But there's other people, of course, that I haven't met. So, I can't say categorically where they are, because I haven't met them. I can investigate, and usually investigate very fast where they are, and say where they are even if I haven't met them. But many of them I haven't personally met, because I'm a limited being, just like any other human, and I have I have time constraints. And I can only talk to so many people at once. and beyond that, you know, I have to go through the same human experiences that everyone else goes through. Yeah.
And on that note, we can cut.
All right.